On official servers, a wild dino can reach level 150, while a tech version can reach level 180. Dinos also get a taming buff, depending on how effective the tame was. I'll explain this in a bit, and a tamed creature can gain up to 88 more levels over time after that. A few tames can be passively fed while walking behind them, with their preferred food in your last hotbar slot. When you're close enough, press E to feed it. Make sure to check your taming list. By selecting these, you'll keep track of where the dino is, as well as some important taming information. Other creatures can be tamed by knocking them out and feeding them. Early on, the bolas are essential for this, as they can immobilize some smaller tames while you punch them in the head, use a club, slingshot with stones, or a boomerang to knock them out. If you have a bow or crossbow with trank arrows, or a long neck rifle with trank darts, just remember that the darts are great, but they're more expensive to craft. As long as your bows don't kill the animal you're trying to knock out, use the arrows over the darts. Some, but not all, creatures have headshot multipliers, so in general, aim for the head. Make sure to use a website like Dododex to figure out exactly what food you need and how long it will take to tame the creature. It will be hard to get the best taming foods early on, so for herbivores, medjooberries beat out all the other basic berries, and for carnivores, feed them meat with this general quality guide. Once you start actually feeding a knocked out dino, or if it gets attacked while it's sleeping, it will lose taming effectiveness. Remember that taming buff I mentioned earlier? The higher the taming effectiveness, the higher this percentage buff on your tame's final level. To maximize this, try starvation taming. If a creature can be tamed by knockout, just torpor it and leave it alone for a while. Its food stat will slowly decrease. Once it has enough space in its belly, drop all the needed food into its inventory and it'll devour the entire stack fast, maximizing your taming effectiveness. Careful though, some dinos wake up quickly. To keep them asleep, get berries or narcotics, but berries are easy enough to find, and force feed the sleeping dino by holding E on the stack in its inventory. Okay, time for some bigger game. Some of the larger tames will need to be trapped. There's a few methods for this. Here's what I did. Try a small pen with foundations, walls, and a ramp on one side. You'll need a door if you plan to escape out the other side though. If the dino you're trying to tame is too large to fit through a door, you can even just use the door structure instead. An alternative to walls are gates. These things don't need foundations, and the doors can be set to automatic, manual, or on a timer. Some dinosaurs cannot pass through the smaller gates, so you won't even need to place a door in them. They'll wall in the dino for you. The largest tames, like a Triceratops or T-Rex, can even be trapped with pillars, which, again, won't need foundations. Finally, if you're trapping a tame that can fly, you'll need a ceiling, so plan your trap accordingly. Here's how I trapped an Argentavis, for example. Oh, and you can build structures while on a mount. Just make sure the structures are in your inventory and select them with E while riding. There's tons of tames out there. In general, I collected tames that were only high level, since the lowest level stuff dies too easily in combat. However, if you only need a tame for something safe at base, I tended to just grab the first one I found. Once tamed, remember that many creatures have multiple attacks. Here's a quick list of useful early-ish tames. Parasaurs have good carrying capacity and are decent at collecting berries. It can also scan to detect nearby predators. Dodecurus mines stone like crazy. Maximize weight since there's stone everywhere, but the ankylosaur is better for metal, crystal, obsidian, and flint. For them, you should maximize attack to get more resources per hit. The trike's amazing for berries, among other things. I abandoned my parasaur once I got one. A raptor party's good for hunting meat and hide. Sabertooths harvest extra chitin and keratin. Pteranodons will likely be your first flyer. Stun with Ebola and knock it out with punches. Argentavis are amazingly versatile flyers. Not as fast as a pteranodon, but superior weight and stamina. It can also pick up lots of smaller creatures, and I use this to carry potential tames to a safe trap. They also carry your Dodecurus and your Anki to harvest materials on the fly. The Stegosaurus has multiple combat modes, but it's not very mobile. Good at collecting wood though. Dung beetles collect poop to make fertilizer for your farm, and they produce a bit of oil as well. I only used Carbonomus to transport stuff across the water, but their shell reduces damage taken, making them useful for survivability and defense. Therizinosaurus can be tricky to tame, but they're amazingly versatile. I used these to traverse many dangerous caves early on. They're also great for collecting fibers, berries, wood, and thatch, with the bonus harvest level selected through the character wheel, and they get the herbivore fire resistance buff as well. Now for some advanced tips you'll want to know for later on. Shoulder tames have various benefits, like being able to knock survivors off their rides or to light the way, but I found the otter to be incredibly useful. They're the only tame that can carry multiple artifacts at once, so stick around an artifact spawn point and get a bunch on each run. To put it on your shoulder, press E, and to take it off your shoulder, double tap F. If you get your your hands on Sweet Veggie Cakes, you can tame Ovis. They provide mutton, which is decent for taming and cooking. And if you have a chainsaw, you can harvest a lot of mutton. I mean, look at these numbers, they're just too good. A U-Tyrannus is a great mount for fearing away enemies and buffing allies, but they also drop special tier eggs, and those are useful for making exceptional kibble, the best kibble in the game. All the wyverns are cool AF. It can be hard to steal an egg, especially if you're playing solo or on Vanilla Ark, but if you do get your hands on one, know that there are regular and crystal varieties. The tropical wyvern in particular is great for transportation, as they get a speed and regen buff when they touch water. The regular varieties have more health and damage, but they're all unique enough that I wanted one of each in my game. Breeding is very important in this game. Some tames, like a Carcinos and Griffin, can't breed new babies, so make sure to check a wiki if you want to know this before spending all that time finding, trapping, and taming a creature. Once you have a male and female, make sure that they're next to each other and enable breeding. When they're done, you'll see a timer depicting when the female can breed again. Tames that don't drop eggs will become pregnant instead, and you'll need to keep an eye on this timer since the parents will not care for the babies once born. Fertilized eggs will have this red smoke emanating from them, and they won't expire if you pick them up or place them in storage. They do need specific temperatures to hatch though. A raptor or parasaur egg, for example, may hatch on its own if the environment is favorable, but here's some simple tips to help hatch harder eggs. Build an enclosed shelter to help with climate control. Early on, you may only have thatch, but upgrade to wood, then stone, then metal as soon as you're able. Now you need to provide heat. Just place standing torches or campfires around and drop the egg. Now observe and notice if it's too hot or cold, then turn on or off fires to catch that sweet spot. Much later on, air conditioners make all this trivial, as they control the climate to the perfect level every time. Okay, so now you're a parent. Time to feed and imprint on your babies. Newborns can't hold much food in their inventory, so for the first few minutes, you'll have to stick around and keep stuffing them with food. Your goal is to feed them enough food to last until they're about 10% maturation. Around this point, they become an adolescent and will finally be able to eat out of a feeding trough. Once your babies are eating out of the trough, most of the work is done. The only thing left to do is to keep track of these imprinting timers. This is very important, since a 100% fully imprinted tame will get a 30% buff to damage and resistance. Imprinting can start after 4 hours of maturation. At this point, the creature will randomly ask for one of three things. It may ask for a specific food. If you have it on hand, you can put it in your last inventory slot, walk up behind the baby, and feed it with E. Or you might need to take it for a walk. Just whistle for it to follow you and move around. It'll eventually show its appreciation, and then you can stop. Finally, the easiest and preferred option is when the baby asks for a cuddle. Just press E on it. After successfully imprinting, a new 4-hour timer will depict the next time you can do this. Also note that some tames mature so quickly that you won't even be able to max imprint on them unless you're running some mods. Some tames just mature too fast. Lastly, never take your breeding dinos out to fight with you. You cannot afford to lose them since they should have your best stat lines. Take a look at their max level. It's the addition of all these individual stats. Do your best to find a wild dino that maximizes the stats you want. Now, every time two dinos meet, their child will randomly inherit the parents' base stats, ignoring levels after taming. If the baby took all the best stats from both or either parent, use it to replace one of the parents. And note that incest doesn't matter in this game. If you're patient and only replace the parents with objectively better babies, you will eventually create two clones and always get the best stat line on each new baby. Mutations can randomly increase a stat or change the creature's color scheme. This mechanic gets kind of complex, so I encourage you to check out a mutation guide if you really want to min-max your breeding. Be aware of your tame's behavior settings. Passive flee means it will run away from an attacker and eventually stop and stand still. Passive means the creature won't react to any attacks whatsoever. Neutral means your tame will fight back if attacked. And aggressive means it will actively attack anything that an allied creature or player attacks near it. If you notice that your tames are not responding to your commands, check to see if your hot group is full. I find this menu to be rather clunky, so make sure to double check this before getting into a fight. Setting a tame to wander will also allow it to feed itself, but be careful to enclose the space so it doesn't get lost. Make sure to familiarize yourself with all the whistle commands, and don't forget to hold T to access the whistle command wheel. Finally, you can choose which side to dismount by holding that direction when you press the dismount button. If these tips helped, say so in the comments, and sub to join my growing channel.